Let's focus on these three only. There are many. Software mall functions is a pure risk or it is a speculative risk? Software mall functions is a pure risk or is a speculative risk? That means you want to say that the software mall functions is going to give us loss only, pure risk, because you have used the word software mall functions. It is an operational risk, it is a short term risk or a long term risk? It is an operational risk which is short term or it is long term? Operational, long term. But both the words contradict. Generally we say operational means short term. Operational means day to day. Now one more thing. The software mall functions is internal or external? The software mall functions risk is internal or external? Internal. How an internal risk can be controlled? How an internal risk can be reduced when it's pure risk? What can we do for managing an internal risk? We will say better internal control. For internal risk, the internal control should be strong. But the question arises that what is internal control? If I will say that for managing an internal risk, internal control should be strong, then how the internal control can be strong? How can we avoid software mall functions in Infosys or TCS? What we should be doing to avoid software mall functions in Infosys or TCS? So we are saying that to avoid software mall functions, we should have a system that regularly those software which can affect our organization in a great way, we should be checking those systems regularly. The report of checking should be updated in the software. That should be going to the top management. We should be having knowledge if there is any past event where the software mall functions happened, the reason for that happening, that should not recur again. Who is responsible if that software mall functions happened? Who is given this authority or right to control this aspect? Where are the ways where the software mall functions can happen? What are the areas which can create the software mall functions? How can we control them? What procedure we are following to match them? These are the things. There are so many things we can write. I mean to say that there is no limit of risk in any organization. But there are some risks which are more important. The probability of happening those risks is high, and their effect on the organization because of that may also be very high. There may be some risk where the happening, the probability of happening is very low, that the chance of their happening is less. The effect on the organization is still high. There may be some risk. The probability of their happening is very high, but the impact on the organization is low. And there may be some risk. The probability of their happening is very low, and the impact on the organization is also low. So there can be a matrix which can be prepared. And if we, whatever risk is there in any organization, if we categorize those risks into this matrix, high probability, high impact, high probability, low impact, low probability, high impact, low probability, low impact. I'm saying four things. The probability of occurring that risk and the impact on the organization because of that risk. So the probability may be low and high. The impact on the organization may be low and high. And on that basis, whatever the risk in the organization, we categorize into these four categories. And then we think about managing those risks. If the probability is low, impact is low. Generally, we say that they are normal business risk. There is not so much to be done for those risks. Because already wo hoga hi nahi. Aur hoga bhi to, hamare upar effect bahut kam hone wala hai. Lekin if the probability is low, impact is very high, maybe we can say that we will transfer that risk, or the probability is low. Since impact is very high, we need to manage that because it can adversely affect us. Probability is low. But if the probability is high and impact is very low, I think if it is a dual risk, a speculative risk, we should be taking because the impact is low. So maybe when we take that risk and if it is speculating, maybe it can give us income. Or we can say that the probability need to be reduced. The probability is high, impact is low. But how can we reduce the probability? If the probability is high, impact is also high, we should not be taking those risks. Because agar uska probability already high hai, aur wo bahut adversely affect karne wala hai, kya zarurat hai wo risk lene ki? Maybe if you have studied in your life, the word called TARA. Transfer, avoid, accept, reduce. Transfer, avoid, accept, reduce. Accept means low probability, low impact. It was there in P2, it was there in P1, and it is there in P3. But in P1, P2, it was not so advanced level. Here you are studying a subject, pure risk. So yahan par unhone bahut examples diye. Aur limiting example kitne ho sakte, we need to understand. Those risks where the probability is low and the impact is also low, they are normal business risk. Wo hame lena hai. Suppose in Saraf Academy there are 10 staff. Maybe tomorrow one staff will not come. Probability kya hai? Bahut zyada hai. Nahi aayega to kya hoga? Eid hai bhai. Ho sakta hai koi Muslim hai, nahi aayega. Probability is very high. Usse kya impact hoga Saraf Gurukul pe? No impact. Uska kaam balance log karenge. But if I will say that tomorrow all 10 will not come, probability is very low. And if it will happen, it has effect. I will not say huge effect, but it has effect. So what is the plan for that? No plan. Lekin, I mean to say that aap koi bhi organization ke baare mein koi bhi risk ki baat kar rahe hain, you need to first of all identify, maybe there are 50 types of risk which can arise, and you need to categorize those risks into these four categories. This categorization may be subjective. Maybe Manish will say that this risk impact is low. I will say that probability is high, impact is also high. And Vaibhav will say that probability is low, impact is high. Ulta pulta ho sakta hai. Lekin main bhi right hu, Manish bhi right hai, Vaibhav bhi right hai. When I am saying, for my saying, I am giving logic. Manish is also giving logic. Vaibhav is also giving logic. Yahan koi 2 plus 2, 4 ki baat nahi ho rahi. It's your own way of saying the thing. If you don't have logic, you are wrong. If you have logic, maybe your view is different than me. You are correct. The problem arises that when the objective type questions are there, then wahan to jo answer hai, wahi hoga na. To hum log ko unke soch se soch milana hoega. So sometimes it happens that not every question, maybe out of 100, 3-4 questions you will find that you have a different logic and the answer is on the basis of a different logic. I'm not saying that I'm wrong or you are wrong, but still agar wo wrong hai, zero hi milega exam. Because objective type question are not human marked. In ACCA syllabus, we don't have objective type question at professional level. All questions are detailed. So in ACCA, the tension is not there. Because if you have a different logic and you are justifying, you will be given full marks. But CIMA mein ye problem rahegi ki agar koi question mein confusion hai aur aapka logic sahi hai, lekin institute ne alag logic lagaya hai, aapko number nahi milenge. Ye problem hai. Because objective type is human marked nahi hai, computer marked hai. To agar answer A, B, C, D mein se C hai aur aapka logic A bol raha hai, maybe you are not wrong, but the marks will be zero. But that will not arise in 100 out of 100 question. I am just saying you. Because there are many times when the student asks question in CIMA. Or phir ye hota hai ki main bolta hu ki hona chahiye, main unko deta hu logic. But institute. No. You check your my CIMA account, the number there will be they have given. You will not get the marks when you give the exam. At that time you are known pass or fail. But you have not checked your CIMA ID. You go into your CIMA, my CIMA account, the number is updated within 48 hours. So you check your my CIMA, you will get the marks. Marks are hai, sir. Kaha nahi aa raha hai. You can't see question and answer. That they will not say. But how much you have scored in 150, that you can check in your my CIMA account. You go to in CIMA Institute website, log in, you will get your mark sheet. No, that is not kintu parantu. That is happening since last 3 years. Why they are not saying the marks at that time? Because when you have given the exam, they want to see the 90-hour video, whether you have used any unfair means or not. Otherwise, your exam will be cancelled even though you passed. That is provisional pass, it will be declared fail. But if the student has not done any unfair means, unethical thing during 90 minutes, and then they release the results in your my CIMA account with your marks. Because marks to 2 seconds mein aayega na. Ki suppose you have done 50 correct. All questions are equally marked, whether they are easy or wrong. So 50 into 2.5 you will get. Because for 60 questions, 150 marks. For 50 right, you will get marks that way. It is very simple. But why the marks is not announced at that time? Because it is a provisional result. They will check your recording when you have given the exam. That is physically, because on your top when you have given the exam, the camera is there. So they will check the camera that whether the student has done any unfair means. Then the result is announced to the student. It is in ACC also. In ACC also, the paper based exam F1 to F4. When the student complete the exam, at that time the results are not announced. The result is announced later on. And I think this is logical. Because maan lijiye, suppose I have an exam center, because we are opening ACCA exam center at our place for F1 to F4. Student bahar aa ke sara question mere se pooch liya. So in that case, agar wo bahut bar during the exam time, when the student go out of the exam hall where the exam center is there, then in that case uska exam cancel ho jayega. Aap ek ya do bar washroom jayenge na, kitni bar jayenge? So that is not allowed. And these questions, since computer based, there is no paper which you can take out. To aap agar jyada bar bahar ja rahe hain, then in that case the exam will be cancelled. Because kuch to niyam kanun banana hoga na, otherwise to everybody will pass without any efforts. Marks showing 100, to exact pass hua mere bhai. You did exactly 40 correct. On borderline, subcd 99 ke badle 100. Sorry. Because out of 150, 100 is pass marks. Two-third. So out of 60, you did exactly 40 correct. Ek bhi kamti right hota jaate. Chaliye, good. It has not given you the bad dreams. But they will not show you the question and answers, man. And at the same time, there is a question bank when you are giving exam. 500 to 1000 questions. Out of that, the questions are automatically selected. So that they will not give. Ha ha ha. the objective type question they will not share. I can say that those questions are whatever was there in your Kaplan, BTP and all that. He will say that they were not like that, but that is that only. Ab exactly comma full stop to same hoga nahi, but he will not get the questions. Okay, not attention, but I am saying that we need to classify the risk into four categories, and those risks which have high probability, high impact, high probability, low impact, we need to reduce their probability. And those risks which has low probability, high impact, low probability, low impact, low probability, low impact are normal business risks. Nobody can avoid that. But low probability, high impact, we need to try that the impact should be reduced. If it is pure risk. So when we classify the risk into different categories, then the management will be better, because we come to know that out of 50 risk, these 10 are more important. We need to manage them, because whatever step we are taking, we cannot say that the risk is zero. That will never happen. Koi cheez aisa nahi hai jo risk ko zero kar de. If you are doing business, you have to take risk. But by categorizing the risk, by identification of risk, we can reduce their probability, we can reduce their adverse impact on the organization. As far as the categorization is concerned, that is subjective. You may have a different opinion than mine. Now, when we are saying that there can be 50 types of risk, we should be dividing those risks into broad categories. That this may be strategic risk, long-term risk, this may be normal business risk, operational risk, this may be financial risk, this may be economical risk, this may be, you can say, natural hazardous risk, there can be, this may be political risk, this may be fraud risk, whatever. I mean to say that maybe the risk can be 1,000 types of risk, but you need to divide them into broad categories. And in all those categories, you need to identify the risk in the business. You need to identify whether they are pure, whether they are speculative. When they are pure, how you can reduce them, how you can make yourself that you can handle them. If they are speculative, whether you should be taking that risk or not, how you can take, how you can do the hedging, that they have written in chapter one. Not that they have written the hedging, but what is risk? What is risk categorization? What is TARA? What are the different types of risk which an organization may face or faces? As I said earlier also, I'm not going into language. I'm just saying that there can be two types of risk. Risk is often thought of as pure risk, downside only, but it must be considered that risk can also be good. The results may be better than expected, as well as worse than expected, which is called upside risk. Why we take upside risk? Why we take speculative risk? To gain competitive advantage and to increase return. Then they are saying about CIMA risk management cycle. Now, since the word is CIMA risk management cycle, ACCA will never write that. But ACCA has written not that ACCA risk management cycle, but these things are written not as a CIMA risk management cycle, I will show you, but same thing are written relating to risk management. The first thing is that you need to identify the risk for your business. How you will identify? The risk identification can be done through two things. Establish risk management group and set goals. Second, business strategy. Now, their business strategy means what are the long-term ways of growth for the organization. The long-term ways of growth for the organization may be organic, may be inorganic. Organic, we will be doing everything on our own. Inorganic, we will be acquiring another organization. Whether we go for organic growth, risk is there. Whether we go for inorganic growth, risk is there. Whether we will be acquiring new market, whether we are going to develop new product, whether we are going into diversification, what is our strategic goals? What is our long-term goals or long-term way of growth? Because the long-term risk can be identified through your long-term strategies, which is called business strategy. For identifying, there is obviously in the organization, there should be a, you can say in listed companies generally, there is a risk management committee. Risk management committee. And in that risk management committee, there are 2-3 persons who has been given the responsibility, regular identification of risk. Suppose I will say that in Reliance Industries, there are 2-3 persons who have been given this responsibility. What is the meaning of this? It is not that they will be going into every area of Reliance. Whoever is working in any department, in any portion of the organization, they have been given certain guidelines which they need to communicate to these three persons, 2-3 persons. And on the basis of that communication, those 2-3 persons will be able to come to know new type of risk which may be arising in the Reliance. So first part is identification of risk. Because aapko pata hi nahi hai ki risk kya hai, to aap kya management karoge. So that identification is based on two things, on the basis of our long-term plans, long-term strategies, on the basis of there is a group formed in the company, better companies, professionally managed company, who will be regularly identifying the risk with the help of their efforts. Once the risk is identified, we need to understand and scale of that risk. Understand and scale of that risk is actually we called identification of the probability and the impact. कि वो रिस्क का होने का चांस क्या है और उससे क्या एडवर्स अफेक्ट हमारे पे पड़ेगा, मेरे को वो जानना है. अंडरस्टैंड एंड एसेस द स्केल ऑफ रिस्क. देन कम्स डेवलपमेंट ऑफ रिस्क रिस्पॉन्स स्ट्रैटेजी. वंस वी आइडेंटिफाई दैट द रिस्क द प्रोबेबिलिटी इज दिस, देयर कैन बी सो मच लॉस टू द कंपनी, दिस कैन बी द इश्यू, देन वी विल थिंक दैट हाउ कैन वी मेक अवर प्लान्स, व्हाट वी शुड बी डूइंग so that we will be able to deal with risk better. Risk response is strategy. For a particular risk, how we are going to manage that risk. Implement those strategy and allocate responsibilities. We will implement the best strategy or strategies to manage those risk. And for managing those, the implementation involved giving authority, guidelines, responsibility to persons who will be doing what, so that the risk can be managed. Implementation and monitoring of control. When you have given certain persons authority or responsibility, you need to check whether that person is doing the same thing or not, whether he is doing in the right direction or not. Because if control is not there, giving the responsibility is not over. You have to control. And then once you are controlling, once the risk is under implementation, you need to check whether that risk for which you have developed the strategy, whether it is giving you the desired result or not. Whether by implementation of that strategy, we have been able to manage that risk or not. That is called review and evaluation. And this process go on as a cycle. Go on as a cycle. Go on as a cycle. And this whole cycle depends upon information, communication, software, IT. सारे चीजों को एक बीच में किससे रिलेट किया गया, आईटी से. बिकॉज इफ आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट अ मल्टीनेशनल कंपनी मारुति और आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट होंडा और एनी टाइप ऑफ कंपनी, उनको हर जगह फिजिकल आदमी रखेंगे. नाउ तो देयर इज ड्रोन, देयर इज रोबोट्स, देयर आर सो मेनी थिंग्स डेवलपिंग. उससे ही सब कुछ मैनेज होगा. ये सारी चीजें इससे रिलेटेड है. हर चीज जो बिजनेस में हो रही है for management of risk through help of IT information technology, which is treated as a risk management cycle. The same thing is written in ACCA material 365. Sorry. I need to open and reopen this again. I will be giving you the material tomorrow morning because I was doing a better structuring of the material so that the student will be able to understand them better. So for all the subject, the structuring was done at around 6:20. Then the staff went away. For that reason, he will be giving material tomorrow morning. The risk identification is written here as a risk awareness. With that, we will be able to find out the different types of risk which an organization may arise. They have given some examples: strategic, tactical, operational. Then their assessment and monitoring. That is the probability and their effect on the organization. With the internal audit, with the information system, we will be doing that. And then the risk management. What is the risk management? That is the mitigation policy strategy. They have given an example. How can we hedge any risk? How can we diversify any risk? Then the TARA framework they have written. How can we treat that risk? How we should be approaching to solve that risk? Then they have written into great detail what are the types of risk. Same way in CIMA also, after this, one second, when we studied this risk management cycle, in CIMA they are asking a question. Risk management cycle identifies various activities that should be undertaken during risk management. Which of the following options shows the steps in the correct order? Identify the risk, develop risk response strategy, allocate responsibilities, establish risk management group. Establish risk management group, identify risk areas, allocate responsibilities, develop risk response strategy. Allocate responsibilities, identify risk areas, develop risk response strategy, establish risk management group. Establish risk management group, identify risk areas, develop risk response strategy, allocate responsibilities. Actually, A is wrong because establish risk management group is the first. Establish risk management business strategy, on that basis you identify. In A, it is written at the end. Wrong. In B, it is written establish risk management group. Identify risk areas, allocate responsibility, develop risk response strategy. The last two should be reversed. Develop risk response strategy, then allocate responsibility. So B is wrong. C is purely wrong. Allocate responsibility kahan se aa gaya? In D it is written, first of all, establish management group. identify those risks, develop risk response strategy, and then allocate responsibilities. So A is wrong because of the last part, establish risk management group. That should be the first step. Establish the risk management group and business strategy, identify the risk. After identification, understand the scale and effect on the organization. Once you do that, develop the strategy by which you can manage those risks. Once you fix the strategy, implement those strategies by giving responsibility allocations and all that. Then control the staff, control that everything is being done in the same order, and then evaluate whether the risk is managed or not. Then again do the same thing, and in all those things think about IT information and all that. That they are saying. Now identification of risk is not a one day affair, cannot be done by one person. Maybe there is a cell, but it should be a day to day affair for everybody in the organization. We need to say to everybody who is working in the organization, while doing the work, what are the things they need to report. When they will report, automatically the management will understand the risk. Now in CIMA, the total categorization is done in these points: political risk, business risk, economic risk, financial risk, technology risk, employment risk, corporate risk, fraud risk, international risk. It is not that there is any law ki itna hi hota hai. आपको जो समझ में आए आप डाइवर्सन कर सकते हैं, बट आई लाइक दैट द वे द प्रेजेंटेशन इज डन. पॉलिटिकल एंड लीगल रिस्क. इंडिया में अभी पॉलिटिकल रिस्क चालू हो गया बिकॉज द इलेक्शन इज ऑन वर्ज इन 2019 बिगिनिंग. देयर विल बी इलेक्शन, वेदर बीजेपी विल बी देयर, वेदर देयर विल बी वन पार्टी, वेदर देयर विल बी कॉम्बिनेशन कोलिशन ऑफ गवर्नमेंट. सो जनरली द आउटसाइडर्स विल नॉट बी इन्वेस्टिंग इन इंडिया फॉर कमिंग वन ईयर. Because different government has different types of policies. So for that reason, I will say that in India, political risk is high presently. Legal and regulatory risk, Modi ji has already taken, sleepless nights given to many. The demonetization, GST, whatever he has taken. And I think he is not doing wrong, because whatever the black money is there, if it becomes white, the growth of India will be there. But we can say that the legal and regulatory, these legal laws relating to health, safety of employees, pollution, whatever you say, those are treated as political and legal risk. Are they pure or they are speculative? Are they pure or they are speculative? Because ये भी तो हो सकता है कि एकदम मेजोरिटी इंडिया में आ जाए, अच्छा हो जाए, तो भाई स्पेक्यूलेटिव है. साथ में एक्सटर्नल है, हमारे हाथ में कुछ नहीं है. आई एम नॉट दैट आई कैन सेलेक्ट बीजेपी और कांग्रेस, इट इज नॉट इन माई हैंड. द लीगल लॉज एंड रेगुलेटरी थिंग्स आर नॉट इन एनीबडीज कंट्रोल, सो दे आर वेरी मच एक्सटर्नल. बट सिंस इट इज एक्सटर्नल, यू कैनॉट से दैट हम क्या करें. वेन यू नो दैट समथिंग इज गोइंग टू एडवर्सली अफेक्ट यूर बिजनेस, यू नीड टू बी प्रिपेयर्ड फॉर दैट. When you know that something is going to positively affect your business, there are opportunities, you should be prepared for that. So, us tarah se risk ko soch raha. Business risk, the business risk can be, we can say, strategic or can be operational. The operational are short term risk. Koi staff nahi aayega, koi din kuch ho gaya, that is called operational. But strategic means what? Long term. Inorganic, organic, those types of risk. But business has both types of risk. Economic risk, interest rate, inflation, per capita income, GDP growth rate, unemployment, all these are economic risk. When the economy is growing, all the businesses in the country will be growing. Indian economy is the fastest growing economy in the world for the time being. So economy is good, which is good for everybody in India. But there are other problems, the issue in India is relating to corruption. Maybe growth is there, but the corruption is very high. So economic risk relating to those areas. Financial risk, foreign exchange risk, interest rate risk. You will say that economical and financial. You are saying same thing. You can say economical and financial. But if I will say economical and financial separate, the interest rate, foreign exchange, political risk may be coming under financial. You will see that ki political to top may be a financial ki andar bhi. If you are doing any foreign direct investment in any other country, your investment, your return, your everything depends upon political risk of that country. In that we teach financial. But if I am saying that I am already in a country, I am already the domestic company for a country, the political risk in that country is actually a political risk. Technology risk, it is relevant for everybody, for me to very high, for others also. I am not saying it is adverse only, for me it is a speculative risk. If I will don't invest in technology, I cannot grow. But if I will do investment in bad technology, I can suffer. If I will invest in good technology, I may grow. But for every business, technological risk is there. Environmental risk, you can see rainfall, what do you say, drought, whatever. Those risks may be less for Saraf Academy, but it is more for certain types of organization, maybe insurance companies, maybe banks, those who have given loans and all that. So maybe some type of risk is more important for some organization. For some organization, it is less important. Corporate reputation risk. जिसका नाम है इज्जत है उसको खोने का डर है, जिसका नाम और इज्जत ही नहीं उसको क्या होएगा. सो कॉर्पोरेट रेपुटेशन रिस्क इज रेलेवेंट फॉर देम हु हैज रेपुटेशन, इट इज नॉट रेलेवेंट फॉर देम दोज हु डोंट हैव रेपुटेशन. नेस्ले, मैगी, कोका कोला, कैडबरी, दे हैव रेपुटेशन, सो दे आर ऑलवेज कंसर्न विद द डिमिनिस इन देयर रेपुटेशन. फ्रॉड एंड एम्प्लॉई मालफेसेंस रिस्क कैन बी पार्ट ऑफ बिजनेस रिस्क ऑल्सो, बट इफ इट कैन बी रिकॉर्डेड एज सेपरेट. कि कोई भी फ्रॉड, इंप्लॉई वगैरह, व्हेनेवर वी बाय एनी प्रोडक्ट और सर्विस फ्रॉम एनी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, देन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन ऑफ इंप्लॉईज वी डिसाइड वेदर वी शुड बी बाइंग द प्रोडक्ट. मे बी फॉर इंप्लॉईज हु आर सेलिंग द प्रोडक्ट, हु आर सेल्समैन, दे आर कम्युनिकेटिंग रॉन्ग इन्फॉर्मेशन, दैट इज द रिस्क ऑन द पार्ट ऑफ द कंपनी, वेरी मच हाई इन केस ऑफ बैंक्स, फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशंस. Or maybe the employees are committing fraud, they have been given the opportunity to do the fraud. How can we, that all are treated as employee or malfeasance risk. Internal, international risk. For an organization which is domestic, the risk are less. For an organization which has operations in other countries, the risk are more. Because in other countries, there is, you can see, cultural risk. The Indian culture, the other country culture is different. You can see legal risk. Indian legal system, outside legal system is different. You can say transportation risk, whenever we have business outside, there are so many transportation of goods and services. So how they will be transferred and all that, the customs duties, custom rules and all that, all those create extra risk. So we can say that for a foreign exchange risk, for an international company, for a multinational company, international risk are more. Foreign exchange risk are more for a as compared to a domestic company. This is not the exhaustive list. This is just, we can say that mota moti, if we want to incorporate all the types of risk in any business, they may fall in these categories. They have written a big example which is not written in ACCA material but in CIMA material written relating to economic risks of time crisis. That is during 2002-03, when US is under deflation, then the interest rate was reduced to even 1%, less than 1%. So that the people will borrow, people will buy houses to grow the economy. When people will borrow, people will buy the houses. So the construction company will develop more and more buildings. When the construction company will develop more and more buildings to satisfy the demand, then the construction company will be requiring cement or whatever you say, the basic materials. So those things will also be, so the downfall can be overcome. So you can see that till 2006 to 2007, there were huge demand for houses and all that in US. Even though people don't have money, they were borrowing like anything. Small people don't have so much earnings, buying the houses by borrowing beyond their boots. Then later on, when the installment, because earlier the interest rate was lower, later on when the interest rate starts increasing and people are not able to pay the funds, that is those who have borrowed for housing loan, they are not able to pay the installment interest and all that, then the big problem arises. That is, they have funded from banks and they are not paying to bank. So bank is not able to meet their liability. And what bank has done? Bank has created, you can say, special purpose vehicles. issued in the market different types of bonds with different tranches, that is payable in 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. Those bonds were purchased by big financial institutions, big banks, and then the big banks and financial institution has sold those bonds to different countries, you can say Greece and all that. So it's a small thing created havoc in the entire world, which we all were facing till 2012-13. The problem which arises in 2007-8 was entire world was facing till 2012-13. A small issue created something. Many have stated that as, you can say, weapon, financial weapon to destroy the financial market of the world. After 2012-13, some improvement is there. But still, Europe is already facing all those issues still. Europe has huge money, that is other thing. But still, they have not been able to overcome from those situations which happened in US crisis. You know that there are some European countries which faced. So they have written a good understanding that if somebody don't have knowledge of subprime, not that they are asking subprime because it's old story. But just that by reading that, we understand how the small economical issues can create a problem. So that they have written in different portions, some examples obviously need to go through, but not that the only example is possible. You need to open your mind. You need to think around what are the risks which is happening in these areas, and then you can have a very good examples on those risks. So they have written a huge, you can say, in CIMA and ACCA material relating to different types of risk. In between, they have written some questions that whether you have understood or not. If I will say, suppose this, during their work on WorldCom and Enron, Arthur Anderson, chartered accountants and registered auditors, failed to identify serious irregularities in these companies. This led to their demise. This was mainly due to, pick one answer, business risk, political risk, environmental risk, reputational risk. During their work on WorldCom and Enron, Arthur Anderson, chartered accountants and registered auditors, failed to identify serious irregularities in these companies. This led to their demise. This was mainly due to business risk, political risk, environmental risk, reputational risk. If I will go into one by one, I don't think so it is a political risk, because this was not due to any political activity. Environment, this is not due to environment. There is no natural calamity or like that. So it can be business risk or it can be reputational risk. Why it cannot be business risk? So we are saying that their reputation is adversely affected because of these two fraud which happened in WorldCom and Enron. Because of that, their reputation is adversely affected. For that reason, they shut down. And I think then they become E&Y. E&Y is out of Arthur and Anderson or HPWC. I don't exactly remember. Yeah, E&Y only. Then Arthurson changed and it becomes E&Y. Okay. Why it is not business risk? Because it is not something which is saying about business operations or that is saying about business strategies. It is saying about a firm which is very famous in the world for doing auditing and these consultancy work. They have not been able to identify some problem in their clients' business. Since they were very famous, they lost their reputation so much that they need to close down. So it's a reputational risk. But it is not political and environmental risk, that's sure. Some confusion may arise relating to A and D.